worship and praise him. Even today, we think about people that have left this world. There are those who are attending funerals. Mm-hmm. Remember the Lord saying in Luke chapter 9, he said there was a man that wanted to follow him one day. And the man said, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. Mm-hmm. And Jesus turned around and looked at him and said, let the dead bury their dead. But you go and preach the kingdom of God. Amen. There is an urgency when it comes to the gospel.
All right.
It's not time to just start doing things that are useless and worthless. The dying of someone is special to us.
Man.
You know, it brings hurt. It brings sorrow. It brings tears. But Jesus said, we should not even let that get in our way.
Amen.
When it comes to worshiping and serving him, there are other people out there that are able to take care of that service.
Amen.
You know, sometimes we need to recognize that if, you know, a certain time has been set and that people have passed on to the other side, and if it interferes with Lord's Day worship, we should consider Lord's Day worship.
Amen.
Nothing is important that our Lord's Day worship.
Amen.
And so we want to just understand and really be wholesome and holy unto those things. I want you to turn with me to the book of St. Mark, chapter 12. And we want to continue in our prayers for our young people that are off in college, our young people that Sister Jo was just showing me her grandson who's in the military. Let us continue in our prayers for our military personnel. Because certainly they need our prayers. We thank God. If there are any visitors here today, we want to say again that certainly we do appreciate and we welcome you. We don't want you to feel as though that you're a visitor. We want you to feel as your friend, that you're part of this family until you get in the family. And to those that are on the outside listening in, we thank God for your attention. We just pray and trust that we could just keep it for just a little while. I want to use for a subject, you are not far from the kingdom of God. To hear these words, especially that come from the greatest teacher himself, Jesus Christ. What if you were standing before his presence and you heard him say, you're not far from the kingdom? Even those words alone will not be enough. They will not be enough to satisfy and to put you in the place where you ought to be.
All right.
And we should not even be satisfied with that, because the Lord is saying, because how many times have we seen people that look like Christians? We've seen people that talk like Christians, they act like Christians. And if we were not Christians ourselves and really understood what God means by his word, we look at them sometime and we say that, now that's a real Christian. That's how a Christian is supposed to be. Sometimes they live their lives and they act so much better in their characteristics of life than what we do. And we call ourselves Christians. You know, sometimes we just need to pick up standards of living, I guess, from other people. It sort of teaches us how to live better, to live right. Because when a reflection comes from their life that says that that person is a Christian and he or she is not even a member of the Lord's church, being a morally good person does not qualify you to be a Christian.
Amen.
And there are people who are morally good. They do good things down here. They live good lives. They act as if Jesus wants them to act. But they haven't gone down into the watery graves of baptism.
Amen.
They have not had their sins washed away.
Amen.
They have not had a chance to stand and to hear the truth and to obey the truth.
Amen.
Men are doing and obeying some of everything else other than what the Lord has said.
All right.
You know, we have lost what we call some good people. We've lost people that have touched our hearts tremendously.
Man.
people that have put the greatest influence and impact in our lives. Some have been our mothers, our fathers, sisters, brothers, husband, wife, friends, son, daughters, aunts, uncles, whoever you want to imagine. We've lost some great people.
Amen.
But we must always remember, never to forget, is that we're not exempt. God is not going to keep us here. That one day we all have an appointment to die.
Uh-huh.
And any time that we talk about dying, you read Hebrews 9:27 sometime. It said, and as it is appointed unto man once to die,
uh-huh,
then after death comes the judgment.
All right.
We all have an appointment with death.
Amen.
We're all going to die one time. And we're going to stand before God at his judgment to be judged by him.
Amen.
We're either going to be carried to one place or the other. It is all going to be determined by God.
Amen.
And within his will. You know, dying is something that we often don't like to discuss.
All
right. We can talk about everything that people will tell you often. Just don't talk about dying. Because every time we talk about them, it brings up so many what we call bittersweet memories.
Uh-huh.
No matter how bad a person lived, no matter what they did to us, we tend to almost try to erase the bad things and think about the good things. Those bittersweet moments.
Amen.
But one thing about the erasing part, we can do it all through life. But what really is going to matter is when we stand before God at his judgment. And either he says to us, depart from me, enter into the pits of hell which had been yours. You wanted to live like the devil, then that's where you're going.
All right.
You wanted to disobey my word, then that's where you're going. Or else he would say, enter into the joys of life which had been prepared of you, my Father. Even from the beginning of the world, we're going to be in one place or the other.
All right.
Our world has changed. Our world has changed in so many ways.
Amen. Amen.
And is yet changing.
Mm-hmm.
Each and every day something is different. Things around us, and they are something that we cannot stop. We cannot stop. We can't make things better. Matthew 10:34, the Lord said, think not that I come to send peace upon the earth. I came not to send peace, but rather a sword.
Right.
Amen.
There's a sword been placed in our land. A sword that has been placed in this world. And it has caused all of this division, all of this confusion, everything that goes on. Sometimes we used to say in our life, when a parent kills his child or a child kills their parent, we say, don't you know that was awful?
Mm-hmm.
This father shot and killed his son. This child had risen up and have killed their parent. We used to thought that was the most awful thing in life, and it is.
Amen.
It is indeed one of the most awful things that you can ever hear in this life, but it goes along with what truth is.
All right.
And that's what Jesus said. He said, don't think that I've come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but rather a sword.
Mm-hmm.
I'm come as if there was five people in one house. The father against his son, the son against his father, the mother against her daughter, the daughter against her mother, and the mother-in-law against the daughter-in-law. And then the Lord said, a man's foe, his worst enemy, would be the people of his own household.
All right.
And this is what we're going through in this life, and this is what we see so many times. I remember when I first came into the worship service of the church, I had so many questions. Brother Jack, Brother Homer, Brother Tyler, Brother Kenner, Brother McCullough, Brother Henderson, all of these brethren were willing to be there for those ones that would ask questions. Mm-hmm. We had questions about the cross, questions about ourselves, questions about our lives, and what must I do to be saved? Mm-hmm. And they taken the time and they sat there and they taught us. But our world is not filled with those kinds of questions anymore. Too many times we want to talk about everything else. We just don't want to talk about the cross.
Amen.
Don't mention Jesus. Don't mention God. Don't mention the Holy Spirit. Lord. Bring up every kind of conversation. It make you tickle and giggle and everything else. Lord. Everybody join in those conversations. But you bring up the Bible. You bring up Bible discussion. And you start seeing people just walking away. And you began to wonder just what is our world coming up to and what's going to happen next. These people we can learn to appreciate because we ask all of these soul-searching questions. You know, one thing about the answers is that when you learn the answers, people cannot live a Christian life for you.
Man.
You must live it for yourself. Even those who teach us the truth, they cannot live the life for us. Even they must live the paper lies unto God, even themselves.
Amen.
Read 1 Corinthians, the third chapter.